Hello and welcome to another episode of Toothless MMA Radio's Quick Hitters. I'm your host, John Galloway, and today our guest is an Atlanta, Georgia native and is now making his home in Nebraska. Welcome in, Brian Houston. Brian, how's it going today?
Pretty good. Thank you for having me.
No problem. Thanks for coming on. So, Brian, I was looking here at some stuff on you, and I saw that back in high school, you were a standout athlete. You were doing track, you were doing football, you were doing wrestling. How is all that and evolving your football background going into the college game and then eventually into the arena league? How have those athletic abilities that you have helped you with your MMA career?
When I get out there, normally I have the upper hand in something, whether it's speed, technique, strength, you know. So all the physical aspects of football, all the weightlifting, all the explosion. It's helped me pretty much. You know, it's helped give me a base and it's helped my athletic ability. But, I mean, when I get out there, a lot of these guys don't know about that as far as, you know, training as a, like an athlete. So, I mean, when I get out there, it's everything I've done, you know, from then to now is it's pretty much helped me as far as being able to get out there and just beat them in more than one way. And if I can't muscle them, if I can't just run over them there, you know, we have to find out other ways that we can beat them. And it's hard to find someone that'll be able to be, if a guy's bigger than me, he's probably not in my weight class. And if he is, he's not going to be as fast. I have something over him. If he's smaller than me, then I'll run him over. It's a lot of different ways I can beat guys, and actually from doing so many different sports. I actually did soccer too. So, you know, from doing so many different sports, it's just helped me hone my athletic ability and helped me be a more composed competitor. You know, nothing too much because MMA, combat sports, it's a totally different sport. It's a totally different, you know, mindset. So, well, not totally different mindset, but it's a different experience, you know. So everybody can't do the same thing they did before, you know, for regular sports than they're doing for combat sports.
Right. Now, in your arena league, you played for several teams, but you ended up with the Omaha Beef, which led you to Nebraska, which was where you now make your home. And in the off season, to find something to do, you went to the gym and started doing boxing and MMA. And this became your career. This became where you wanted to focus on. What was it about the boxing and MMA that drew you away from the Arena League football?
I guess because it's a pure sport, you know. I don't have to worry about coaches. I don't have to worry about teammates. I don't have to worry about a whole lot of sideline miles, other people. It's just me, you know. I don't really have to deal with a lot. It's very easy to compete on your own. You know, at the end of the day, you're not mad at anyone but yourself. Team sports, you know, you get mad with everyone, you know, and yourself. It's really hard for me, you know, to be on a team sport. Yeah, it's fun, but it's still frustrating, you know, when everybody's not doing their part. And then there's so many factors, and then a lot of guys, you know, want to be this, and they're not supposed to be that. You know, like a lot of guys want to be the head guy. You're not supposed to be the head guy. You're supposed to be you're supposed to be a role player. Everybody doesn't want to do that. It's just, for me, the transition was easier. You know, I just got tired of the whole, I don't know, I guess you could say this. Well, a couple of my teammates in St. Hampton, too many Chiefs, not enough Indians.
heard that one before.
Now, you know, so, but, and it was a really easy transition, so it was easy to make.
Now, looking back, there was times when you had really hard times and long layoffs in between fights, go out a year, 8 months, different time lengths. And then there was times when you had two fights over a six-week period. Now that you've gone pro, you have a management team, and you're working with out of a gym, is it easier and more consistent to find fights, or are you still finding the trouble that you had before?
Man, it's harder. It's harder to find fights. I mean, when I was on my own, but, you know, less known, you know, like guys will watch film and be like, you know what? He ain't done much. I can get him. Now? Nah, man. I got dudes turning down fights for me left and right, man. I mean, literally, especially since I've been to the UFC, you would figure it would be easier for me. But now guys are just like, they'll look on there and be, oh, no, I'm good. I don't want to fight him. You know, like, it's harder. It's been 4 or 5 months. I was supposed to have a fight last month, but one guy backed out the day they got him the plane ticket. Then the next guy, he got there a day late. It wasn't his fault. But, you know, it's harder, let's put it that way. It's not easier. My role has not gotten easier. The only thing that's gotten really better in this role is me. I'm getting better every day. I mean, granted, the dudes aren't taking fights. It's cool. I mean, it irritates me. But at the same time, I still get up and I go train. So, you know, if you want to wait me out and think I'm a quit, or you maybe think you want to catch me off guard and I'm not going to be ready, whatever, man. You know, do your best. Try to see if you can catch me on a bad day. And, I mean, it really doesn't matter to me. I'm doing so much training. I'm getting better every day. It really doesn't matter who I fight, honestly. But, like I said, it hurts me. It's still hurting my my chances of fighting fights. You know, so, you know, to answer your question, no, it hasn't gotten any easier. It's gotten a lot harder.
Well, let's go back to when you made your UFC debut, or when you were supposed to. You flew out, you started training with Greg Jackson, and you got some news from the UFC doctors that they weren't going to allow you to fight. What was that news?
Yeah, I have a long history of seizures, and I had a benign brain lesion. And they'd never seen it before, so they just wanted to get some more information on it. So they said, well, this is too close to the fight to let you fight, because if anything happens to you, you know, then we're screwed. So they were just like, we're not saying that you can't fight. We're just saying you can't fight now. We just want to see what's up. We want to do some more information. We want our doctors to look at it. And we want to have as much information as we can, you know, so at the end of the day, they're not held liable, you know, for the most part.
Now, after turning pro, you won your first 4 fights. And earn the invitation to the UFC. Once the brain lesion and the seizures were clarified for the UFC, they finally gave you a fight against the guy that you were actually going to replace on the first card, and that came as a quick loss in under a minute in the first round. Your second fight went the whole distance, close split decision. Now, is the level of competition in the UFC that much different from what you were facing previously, or were these just bumps in the road on your way to something bigger and better?
Well, of course the talent level, the talent pool is going to be a lot higher. I mean, it's the best guys in the world. I mean, to be honest with you, when you look at this, when you look at the scale as far as how many guys at each pool, from UFC to the Bellators, I mean, you don't have a lot of guys that can compete that are outside of UFC. You know, like, you got your guys in Titan and maybe World Series, but these dudes are actually trying to work up to get to the UFC. Nobody doesn't want to go to the UFC. You know, there's something holding them back. Either they're not good enough, or it's not their time yet, or they're in a they're in a contract dispute with another promotion. Everybody wants to go to the UFC because, on average, the best guys in the world are there. You know, let's just be real. So, the level that I had to make a change from, I went from, you know, low level, medium level regional guys to, you could say high level. You know, both the guys I fought have fought top 10 guys, you know, in the world. So, you know, they're top level guys, you know. So, and they're both still in the UFC. They haven't gotten cut. You know, they're not bad guys. I should have won both fights. You know, I mean, it was a bump in the road. I mean, it is what it is. The first fight I got caught, you know, it happens.
Yes, it does. I mean,
you know, he came out and he clipped me, caught me in the back of the head. He jumped on top, and I wasn't able to get out the choke. You know, I'd have been happier if he had, tried to knock me out, because at least, I know at least I'd have gotten back up. You know, he got a hit real hard to knock me out. Then the second one, then the second fight, I mean, I was a little nervous. I was a lot more nervous in that one because, I mean, I'd already gotten finished, regardless of how I got finished and whether it was whether it was flu, whatever you want to call it. You know, it was still a 48-second fight, so I was nervous, you know, going in the second fight, and I just really wanted to, I knew I could outstrike him. I knew he couldn't hit me, so I was like, you know what, if I can't knock him out, then I'm just going to point him. You know, it is what it is. Let me get a win, get a little security, and I thought that's what I did, you know, first round. I countered just about everything he did. I kept it on the feet. He didn't get me down on my back till a minute and 30 in the end of the round. I mean, they gave him the round, which is weird. And then the second round, I got a little more. I did a little more push, and I beat him with a stand up, and he couldn't take me down. In the third round, he threw like 7 more punches than me. You know, and hit me maybe 5 times in the last round, maybe. Man, it's weird, man. Like, I don't get it. Every time I watch it, I'm looking at him, giving him compliments for doing, like, throwing combinations. As sloppy as they were, they gave him compliments. Oh, he's putting his combination together now. What do you mean? He didn't even hit me. It was frustrating to actually watch it, because they're like, oh yeah, he's a more aggressive, he's a better striker in this round. I'm like, what do you mean, man? He got a couple leg kicks and a couple sloppy, and like one or two sloppy overhand rights. Like, and I'm like, for real? Like, he hit me with one combination. That's because we were both coming in at the same time. Right, so it's irritating, man. Like, even to listen, like, the whole sport of MMA is like behind in times, man. Like, judging referees are awful, Like, I don't even know what they look for, man. What do they even have an expertise in? Like, what do you have an eye for? Some guys are like, well, I'm a ground guy. Or, what are your full expertise? What is your full expertise? Are you able to see it that he's not doing this? Are you able to see it that they're not doing that? You know, they don't. You know, especially with that last Ross Pearson fight. Who was watching the fight?
Yeah, that's
like,
definitely...
Who watched that fight? Nobody, like, none of the refs, none of the judges watched that fight. I don't think they did. And then these refs, nothing happens to them. Nothing. You don't even get mad at them when they make bad calls, or they don't see a guy got this, or they don't see a dude. You got two guys to look at. That's frustrating. You got two guys to look at. Like, what are you doing? You daydreaming? I don't get how they miss stuff. You're not even looking at anybody else. You got two guys, two dudes to look at, and that's it. You don't have to worry about anything else, yet y'all miss a lot of stuff. And then the judges are awful. Like, it irritates me, man. You know, and then scoring is weird. like you could say you want to be the best in the world, and then, but how can you be the best in the world when the people that, if you let it go to the decision, have the time they know what they're doing? They couldn't know what they're doing. How are you judging and scoring these fights, or are you scoring them? You know, like, I'm not saying I don't want to fight no more. I mean, it's going to pay. It's going to pay off. I just have gripes about how it's done, you know? I mean, granted, you can go in there and say, I'm going to finish everybody. But, no, you can't do that either. It's weird, man. Like, and then when guys are out there throwing punches, it's like they're amateurs. These dudes on their stand-up are amateurs. It's awful. Like, it's irritating. And then the thing that kills me is, especially when you hear commentating, they're sitting there talking about, oh, man, he's looking so good. No, he's not. Stop making him seem better than what he is. He's sorry as hell. Like, really. Like, stop making him seem like he's better than what he really is. He's not good. He's not that good. You know? Like, stop praising dudes for, like, what's that boy name? Diego Sanchez. He said, I think I should win? Because I went for more big finishes. That don't even sound right. Like, did you score when you went for those big finishes? You threw a weak, whack, flying knee that missed his total overall body. But you want to win because you threw it. That's so stupid, man. They're giving dudes points for trying. That's what irritates me. You're giving dudes points and credit and accolades for trying and not even landing. Yeah, it's like, what's the whole point of being a technician? You know, if you're giving these dudes out, if you're giving these cats out here, props for looking bad. You know, like, it's irritating me, man. Like, the more I watch it, the more it irritates me. Like, I don't care what level you're on. 90% of the dudes in this sport can't throw a punch. And the rest of them probably can't wrestle. Like the ones that can't throw real good punches. Oh, ain't that many of them that can wrestle too. You know, I'm not saying nothing about them. They probably the ones that's going to be laying on you. You know, you don't have a whole lot of guys that have a strong ground and a strong stand-up. They don't know what they're doing. It feels like if I just come out there and throw punches and wing them, you know, I'll look good. Maybe if I just throw a whole bunch of punches, maybe they'll give me a point maybe here and there. They'll look like I'm doing something. You're not hitting anybody. You suck. You do. I'm sorry. I'm sitting here ranting, but I'm upset. Okay. I'm literally irritable. I'm upset. You know that you're sitting here giving these dudes all this props, and they're not good. You know, man. I got a teammate about to fight Uriah Hall. I could have sworn this dude was a middleweight. He's only fought a middleweight guy one time, but yet they're gonna give him another welterweight. Man, I hope that dude's going down to welterweight, man. I swear he's so wrong. I hope my teammate gonna beat him up too. He gonna beat him up, and I hope they cut him. Golly. You know, beat him up, take him down, and beat him up more. And that kid ain't going to get away. That's how that fight's going to go. Man, it's coming up, I think it's on the 28th. That's the type of stuff that's irritating me. Sitting here feeding these dudes welterweights that he can't beat. He's lost every welterweight he fought. Oh, man. Oh, man. This stuff's been on my mind lately. It's irritating me, pissing me off.
Well, I'm glad they were giving you an outlet for it.
Yeah. Let everybody know how I feel. And any fighter that doesn't like it, any fighter that feels like, oh, he just running his mouth, he didn't mean in the UFC anyway. How about this? If I can't fight you in the UFC, come down to the gym and try me. You know what I mean? Most of them won't anyway. They already know I'm telling the truth. So, that's irritating, man. You know, I guess because, you know, I'm with guys and I see guys trying, like even ground guys sitting there doing their best. throwing good technical stand-up shots, you know, and then you see these other dudes, you know, I'm just going to lay on you. Oh, man, I swear, I'm done now. I'm done now.
Let me ask you this. Where does your contract stand with the UFC? Do you still have more fights on your contract?
Oh, no. I'm cut.
You were cut.
I got cut after my last fight. Well, I didn't get cut immediately. They didn't want to get rid of me, but they had someone call down from the finance office. They said, well, we have to get rid of some guys, so we're going to get rid of you, let you go back and get some experience because you're so green right now, and you're so new in your pro career. Go back, get some fights, and come back, which is cool.
So now, where are you fighting now?
Wherever I can get fights. That's why I said it's harder now.
Okay.
You know, since I'm outside the UFC, it's harder now to find fights.
Okay.
Just because, I mean, I'm not like on a skid. I'm not sorry. You know, I mean, if a guy does beat me, he's going to get a look to go to the UFC. But no, nobody wants to.
Now, do you have a landing spot in mind, someplace you'd like to end up?
As far as what?
As far as another organization in the meantime while you work your way back into the UFC?
Well, yeah, of course. I mean, but I'm not going to, that's the thing, I'm not going to fight that many fights. So I'm not going to, like, go to someone with, like, a multi-fight deal for, like, four fights or something. I'm going to fight, like, two, maybe three more fights. And then we're going to call the UFC back. Tell them we're ready to come back. I'm going to go back. Yeah. I mean, it's that we have a plan. You know, we just need the fights for the plan. And just right now, it's far and few between. That's all. You know, we're about to go into the middle of the year, and I still haven't had a fight yet. It's a timing issue. You know, just waiting for the right opponent, really just waiting for an opponent. I mean, because I'm not looking for the right opponent. I really just need an opponent. I look at it like this. If I can't beat you, then I shouldn't be in the UFC. You know? And I believe in my heart that I should be in the UFC. I know. You know, that I can go and I can compete with anybody. So, I mean, it really don't matter who I fight outside the UFC. Because, I mean, hell, I train every day. So, it's really just finding a fight. Finding somebody willing to fight me.
Gotcha. Now, while you're training every day, you still have your sponsors that are allowing that to happen, correct?
Well, yeah, I mean, I have my sponsors. I also have my gym. They're helping me out. So, I mean, I have help. You know, I look at it like this. I'm not getting paid right now, but with everyone around me and supporting me, like my sponsors, management, and my gym, I don't have to pay for really anything right now. You know, so I don't really have bills, which is a good thing. I'm just not making money. You know, or fighting, which is kind of hard because that's what I do every day. So,
well, who are these sponsors that are helping you out? Who's the management team?
Well, Jay from Fresh Start. He handles all my sponsors. He's the guy that handles my sponsors. Then my actual management team. That's Monty Cox and Chaz Bowling with. Hey, I forgot the name of the. Oh, man. Team Extreme Athlete. There we go. Team Extreme Athlete Management.
Okay.
And, they're pretty much, they picked me up after my first fight, and it's pretty much been us the whole time. You know, they helped me get there in four fights, you know, and now they're helping me get back.
All right. Now, if people want to keep track and follow you and see when your next fight's coming up, where can they find you on social media?
Well, social media, you can find me on Instagram. Instagram at BBHUEH. That's on my Instagram page. And if you want to follow me on Twitter, it's BBHUEH55. And I have another one. And my Facebook page is just under Brian Houston. And I also have a fan page, Brian B. Hugh Houston. You can find that if you go on Facebook, though, too. And my sponsors that are helping out, Dumachi, they're helping me out with my fight gear. They send me gear. They help me out with my finances. Then we have Smuggling Duds. It's underwear. Ross Pearson, he's sponsored by them too. If you check out his weigh-in video with the underwear that he's wearing, that's Smuggling Duds. And Faction Mouth Guards. They make me mouthpieces whenever I need them. They're actually really, really, really good mouthpieces. They'll make them however I want them. They'll put any type of logos, whatever I want. They're really good guys, too. Then you have Cold One Therapy. Oh, man, they're real good. What they do is they have compression ice packs for different parts of your body, like shoulders, back, neck, knees, ankles, you know, anything you need. I said neck already. Side, like they've got a lot of different ones just for specific body parts. And I know there's another one I'm missing right now. I can't think of it off the top of my head. But if I do before we go, then I'll let you know. Oh yeah. Sports food, man. This might be bar none one of my best sponsors as far as like their product. They're really one of my best sponsors. They're these little strips of they've got electrolytes in them. Like when I'm cutting weight and I'm losing a lot of my electrolytes, I take these and I can take as many of them as I want, and it replenishes my electrolytes whenever I need it. And to be honest with you, that's one of my most beneficial sponsors right there as far as our product goes, because those strips, man, they're a lifesaver. when you sweat it out everything, you've got nothing left. And it's even bad, too, because, my mouth will be dry, but what I can do is I can pour a little water in there, throw a strip in there, you know, shake it around, bam, pour it in my mouth. Helps me, helps it dissolve on my tongue, and bam, got my electrolytes right back. And I can do this while I'm cutting down to my last pound, you know, so they've been a great help. They're actually going to send me some more stuff in a little while, too.
Excellent.
As far as right now, that's about it. That's about all my sponsors. I also want to give another plug for Jay and a Fresh Start. He's been great, man. Ever since I met him, we've never stopped talking on the phone. Never met the guy either. It's funny too. Never met him or never met either one of my managers. He's an unofficial manager. I haven't signed anything with him, but I don't see myself going anywhere. You know, he's doing a great job. A great, great job. Never met him, and I've never met Monty Cox with Team Extreme. It's funny. It's weird, man. The guys that I talk to the most as far as dealing with my career, never met them. Never met them before in my life. Either one of them. But, you know, it's weird because I trust them.
Well, it sounds like they've worked well for you in the past, and it sounds like they're working well towards putting you back into the UFC in the future. Brian, I'm going to wrap this up. When you get another fight, we'd love to have you back on, so that way we can talk about who you're facing and what your game plan is. Would that be okay?
Oh, yes, sir, of course.
All right. Well, this has been another episode of Toothless MMA Radio's Quick Hitters, and our guest today has been Brian Houston. Brian, good luck in the future, and we wish you all the best.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, bye.